Thank you so much for coming today. I'm Abigail Badway. I'm one of the co-presidents for the Sports and Entertainment Law Society. This is part of our SELS Symposium. We're really excited to have you guys. Today we have two speakers. We have Damian Real. He's one of the co-founders of All the Music, Please Pass. Yay. And we have one of our esteemed IP professors, Professor Jennifer Jenkins, and they're going to talk to us a little bit about music copyright. Clap for Jennifer Jenkins.
Oh, Abigail, that was mercifully brief. That's awesome. Everyone asked for a brief introduction, but you, most people don't deliver. You know, you're like reading, and then in high school, you know, she was on junior varsity swimming.
Did you say anything brief before, too?
That was nicely done.
Well done.
I haven't seen so many of you guys without masks on. I'm like, that's John. Hey, everybody. So thank you to Abigail and SELS for sponsoring this event. I am delighted to have Damian Real. Am I pronouncing your last
name? Yeah, Real Nothing.
You're the Real Real, right? Yeah, yeah. Exactly. That's what I thought. I'm so excited to have Damian here because I've been following his work for a while. Damian's a real musician. I'm a fake musician, but he's like really good, and he was a music major, and he can sing. And I think you're going to sing for us a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what brings us together here? We're both musicians. I suck. He's good. We both love music, and we're both lawyers. We're both obsessed with this creature that is music copyright. Unlike me, Damian's also a coder and a technologist. And so I am going to set up the problem that Damian's project, All the Music, seeks to solve. So I'm going to talk for a little while about why music is difficult for copyright to handle. And then Damian's going to tell us about his ingenious solution and why he has saved the world, so far as we can tell, for songwriters, both here and across the pond in the UK. Y'all, Ed Sheeran, Damian just told me I was focused on trademark law. The Ed Sheeran decision came out 6 hours ago from the UK, where he was sued for Shape of You.
The Shape of You, yeah.
Yeah, for infringing Marvin Gaye's copyrights. And the opinion, I gather, reads like you wrote it. So, I mean, I told you so. Yeah? So we can do a little victory dance later. Okay, so let's talk about, look, alliteration. Melodies, machines, and music copyright. So all of these images are from a comic book that Boyle, who you know, and I, with our co-author Keith Aoki, wrote that you can download for free. Why are we obsessed with music? Making it, listening to it, because music touches us deep. I mean, there's probably some songs that have gotten you through the pandemic and through studying and through that stupid Peloton workout and through a breakup and through a makeup, right? Music is important, and it's one of the many art forms that's covered by copyright. But it's been an uneasy relationship. Their relationship status is complicated. Why? The very first Copyright Act in the U.S. protected books, maps, and charts, not music. Music was brought into the copyright realm, the ambit of copyright, by analogy to written text. But guess what? Music is, by and large, something we hear, right? It's vibrations tickling your eardrums and sending signals to your brain. Not really something we look at. I'm going to get to that. And a lot of the doctrinal rules that those of you in my copyright class and in IP are learning about that were developed for the written word just don't quite fit with music as an art form. So let's talk about why that is. Here's my attempt to envision the uneasy relationship between music and copyright law. So one of the visions behind copyright law is that we can all independently create, write our own books, write your own songs, that we're unlikely to converge on exactly the same expression, because if you write something that's substantially similar to something else that's copyrighted, guess what? You're infringing copyright. But what if, in music, songwriters are likely to converge on the same harmonies, the same chord progressions, the same rhythmic beds, the same combination of notes, indeed, the same melodies defined as pitch sequences? You probably noticed that a lot of songs sound the same, right? Is it inspiration? Is it theft? Is it legal? Is it illegal? How do we know? Copyright gives us a very odd apparatus, and perhaps unsatisfying apparatus for answering that question, which is why I'm excited about Damian's project, because it's a different approach to answering that question. For example, this is just, you know, a list I took from Wikipedia of many, many, many songs that share the same four chord progression. Music has a more limited vocabulary than, I mean, you guys are all brilliant, so how many tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of words do you think you know, right? Well, on the Western scale, if you think of the keys on a piano, how many notes do you have to choose from in a melody? You've got 12, and then you repeat in the next octave. So the chance that two melodies are going to share the same pitch sequence gets pretty high. Add to that the harmonic bed that works, and the limited number of combinations of notes that actually sound good, and the constraints of genre, and the long tradition of borrowing and derivation, joyful borrowing and derivation, giving a shout out to your predecessors, building on previous songs and styles in music. A lot of songs are going to sound the same. Here's a somewhat elitist quote from our friend Learned Hand, is the infantile bit. He says, while there are an enormous number of possible permutations of the musical notes of the scale, only a few are pleasing, and fewer still suit the infantile demands of the popular ear. I'll put myself in that infantile category. Recurrence is therefore not an inevitable badge of plagiarism. So that's the problem. A lot of songs are going to sound the same. What is this odd apparatus that I talked about for deciding when you've crossed the line? When borrowing is legal, legitimate, fine, inspiration, creativity, and when it crosses the line into theft, as those of you who are taking copyright know all too well, you've probably been like reviewing this for your exam and you're like, copyright gives us two inquiries and neither one of them fits that well with music. So the first inquiry is the factual copying inquiry. You can't infringe copyright unless you've actually copied in the first place. It's the opposite of independent creation. If Ellen and I, Marcus is a musician. If Marcus and I, you know, like have never seen each other before, and like, you know, he's living in New York and I'm living in California, and we just happen upon the same melody, the theory goes, we can both copyright it, and I'm not ripping him off, and he's not ripping mine off. Sounds great in theory. What happens in practice? And Damien's going to go into this in more detail. The way we figure out whether there's factual copying isn't, oh, hey, yeah, I heard Marcus's song, so I probably copied from him. It's an inference. And it's an inference based on this thing called access. Did I have a reasonable opportunity to hear his song? Guess what? In the world we live in, the streaming era, I have a reasonable opportunity to hear, oh, I don't know, a few million songs. Right? So maybe saving to hear 80 million songs. Add to that these three cases in copyright law that have found that copying music can be subconscious. Subconsciously, I thought I wrote my own guitar. Yeah. But the court will be like, oh no, you subconsciously, your mind played a trick on you. You copied that from Marcus. Maybe independent creation's dead, Damien. You're going to tell us about that. Okay, so that's factual copying. Once we've established factual copying, which is not hard to establish, we look at the vexing question of substantial similarity of protected material. Well, what's the unprotectable material in music? I'm going to talk about that in a second, and we're going to talk about some cases looking at that. I have a slide on this in a second, so just hold on. How do we compare two pieces of music to figure out whether the similarities are substantial? It gets complicated, because I have a quote from a case involving Mariah Carey here, where the Ninth Circuit acknowledged about 15, 16, 17 years ago. It said, oh, man, applying the substantial similarity test to music is a somewhat unnatural task, guided by relatively little precedent. Because music is an art form that produces sounds, expresses moods, but doesn't necessarily communicate separately identifiable ideas. So the Ninth Circuit acknowledges the extrinsic test that it uses provides us an awkward framework, but it's the law, and we must apply it. Why is it so difficult to compare two pieces of music? As I mentioned, music was brought into copyright law by analogy to books, to the written word. But, you know, take two songs, take two country songs that you think sound the same. A visual comparison is going to be very different than an oral comparison. And what happens in practice, in court, with substantial similarity is that we have this two-part test that you guys know all too well, too, where the judge or the jury is invited to, one, use their intellect and use their eyes, And look at that, like Damien knows what that means, but those of you who don't do music, what is that? It's dots on a page, right? So you have expert witnesses coming in and doing like this, drawing these arrows. Oh my God, this looks suspicious. Look, 12 notes are the same. Is that a valid way of comparing music? But then with the second part of the test, the jury or the judge, the intrinsic test, is invited to use their ears and compare the music that way. Well, it's supposed to be substantial similarity of protectable material. How are your ears going to vigorously filter out things like an unprotectable chord progression or a basic rhythm or a sequence of three notes? It's kind of hard to do, right? You sit down and listen to 10 country songs, your ears might say, why, those sound the same. So this exercise of comparing musical works is fraught, to say the least. And we've had a flurry of recent lawsuits demonstrating that. Finally, copyright's a balancing act, right? The rights of copyright are very important. They give incentives to people to create. But there are also exceptions built into copyright law to allow for people to create in the first place. Every creator is straddling both sides of the copyright divide. You're an owner, you're a creator, but you're also a user, a reuser, because it's hard to create out of thin air. You're probably going to be using some element of previously copyrighted works. So what are the avenues in copyright? Copyright, this is Eldred, the Supreme Court, built in First Amendment accommodations. Ideas and facts are never protectable. And fair use. You guys know about these who have taken copyright law or IP. Okay, well, that works well with a book, right? I'm going to give you a book that you're reading. You can probably tell me what the ideas in the book are, probably tell me what the facts are. Music, not the lyrics. Okay, I'm talking about music here, a series of notes. I give you a cluster of 8 notes. What's the idea? The idea in those 8 notes. What's the fact in those 8 notes? This all-important safeguard doesn't do much work when we're dealing with music. Okay, well, what about fair use? Again, I give you the same book. You can use the expression for criticism, for commentary, for review, for quotation, for news reporting, for all sorts of things within the ambit of fair use. This is from our comic book. With music, interestingly, almost all of our precedent deals with parody cases. And the parody cases, not surprisingly, focus on the lyrics, not the music, right? That's how you divine the parodic nature of the second work. So we actually don't have a body of fair use case law that tells us, hey, when can I use your expression, your musical expression, in my music? Yeah. When is what I'm doing transformative? So these two built-in First Amendment accommodations do very little work in the music context. So the balancing act is a challenging one. I'm so glad I teach music copyright, you guys, because it's just like, it never stops. The Ed Sheeran case comes down this morning. What? Dua Lipa just got sued, as my class knows. What? Look how recent these cases are. So this looks like a house or gravestones, but I was trying to make a triptych. Look what's been happening in the Ninth Circuit, the California Circuit. 2018, 2020, en banc 2022. We've had a flurry of music copyright lawsuits, and we've actually had movement, perhaps thanks to Damien, in the Ninth Circuit with how we're going to apply that framework I just told you about to music cases. So I'm just going to walk you through this, and then I'm going to turn things over to Damien. So the case that wigged a lot of people out was the lawsuit against Pharrell Williams and Robin Thicke for their kind of creepy, don't like the lyrics personally, I'm just going to be honest about that as a feminist, okay? But there's some, you know, you can dance to it, Blurred Lines, by the eras of the late, great Marvin Gaye. I'm going to play the signature phrase of these two songs, and then I'm going to show you the transcription. And so you tell me, ladies and gentlemen and people of the jury, what your eyes tell you and what your ears tell you, okay? So this is what the case was about, largely. Here's the first song, Marvin Gaye's song. Can we deal with how loud that is? You sure? You guys are all young, right? You've been to rock and roll shows. We'll just pretend like we're at a show and like there's a big pile of amps there. Okay, did you hear that? I used to go out to parties. That's Marvin Gaye. Okay, let's listen to Blurred Lines.
Hey.
What did your ears just tell you? Do y'all think they sound the same? Okay, so this is the best, it was a $7.3 million verdict. It was, you know, decreased, but this is a big deal. This case was a big deal, okay, and it was affirmed. Okay, so some of the stuff you heard isn't in the composition at all. So some of the rhythmic things, the hi-hat, the use of falsetto, that sort of stuff. We're talking about the notes, the rhythms, the harmonies. So that was your ears. Let's exercise our eyes for a minute. So this was the expert testimony, some of the expert testimony that the verdict was premised on. Oh, look, we're counting notes, aren't we? We're looking at pitch sequences. We're looking at what Justinian's going to do. What were the similarities? A constellation of otherwise unprotectable material, things like a repeated eighth note, a 5-6-1 pitch sequence, a melisma at the end, a melodic contour of the signature phrase that goes up and then goes down. Guess what? You can find those things in lots of songs. But the claim was premised on the recurrence of all these bits and pieces, musical constellations in both of the songs, and the jury was like, ooh, yeah, and the judge too. Looks like infringement to us. Judge Nguyen from the Ninth Circuit in a dissent that was actually quoted repeatedly in the en banc decision, so even though it's a dissent, it's kind of been elevated in subsequent decisions. Judge Nguyen is a music person also, and a judge in the Ninth Circuit. She objected to this kind of testimony, said the expert for the plaintiff cherry-picked brief snippets to opine that a constellation of individually unprotectable elements were substantially similar. Well, that might be reasonable, she says, if the constellations bore any resemblance, but the Big and Little Dipper, they are not. They're just combinations of stars. So that's what happened in the Blurred Lines case. That was sort of the high water mark of the substantial similarity music cases. People freaked out. And this is not a like, oh, you know, academics freaked out because they're all like uncomfortable with copyright. This is like the music industry freaked out. Okay, the RIAA filed briefs talking about this. This is John Legend, who spoke at Duke's graduation maybe not too long ago, right? You don't want to get into this thing where all of us are suing each other all the time because this and that song feels like another song. I'm a little concerned that this verdict might be a slippery slope. Stevie Wonder, who I love, if you haven't, y'all haven't listened to Stevie Wonder, you need to like immediately after this. He said he didn't think it was a steal. Adam Levine, who I'd never heard of, and my students were aghast, so I gather he is very appealing to some people and likes to take his shirt off. He's baffled about the case. Okay, so musicians freaked out, the press freaked out. This is a New York Times article. You can see the lawsuit, a little like, hand coming out of the grave of the piano. And in particular, songwriters freaked out. So this is a quote from the New York Times article. Rank-and-file songwriters started taking out insurance policies because they were worried that if they wrote a melody with a 5-6-1 and a 1-5 and repeated eighth notes that somehow somewhere was similar to something else, they might be on the hook for a jury verdict. And what are you going to do about that? How are you going to say I didn't subconsciously copy that song? How are you going to say that's not enough for an infringement lawsuit? And so these are some quotes from songwriters who are, one of them sadly deceased, for some people you probably listened to. They said it changed their songwriting process. They're starting to second guess themselves, to actually hire experts to be like, hey, did I rip someone off? You know, let's sort of vet this song before I put it out there. So that happens. That's 2018. The verdict is affirmed. Then this happened, and do y'all recognize this font from like Led Zeppelin CDs or not? John, I know you do because you got, yeah, right? Because you sit in front of those posters on Zoom. So in one of the all-time best sort of font situations ever from the complaint. The other great part of this complaint is one of their claims was falsification of rock and roll history, which is not a thing, but it's funny that they put it in there. At any rate, this is the en banc decision from the Ninth Circuit, where 11 judges in the Ninth Circuit said, let's put the brakes on this just a little bit. They said, let's preserve building blocks, individual building blocks of music for anyone to use, such as descending chromatic scales, arpeggios, and maybe three notes, maybe four, maybe not as much as seven, I don't know, 8, 12 short sequences of notes. They are available to any songwriter, any author. And well, what about the claim though that the same combination, the same constellation appeared in two songs? The Ninth Circuit offered us this. They said, yeah, but you can't just have a random combination. There has to be a coherent pattern synthesis or design. It can't just be random similarities scattered throughout the works. So this is the word from on high. There's the stairway to heaven, as we rendered it in our comic book. Pushing back on the kinds of claims that were successful, that was successful in the Blurred Lines case. I want to apologize in advance for this earworm. This ostinato is very painful to listen to, but you're going to listen to it because it involves Katy Perry. So are you ready for an 8-note ostinato? Yeah, you're ready. Oh, yeah.
You know what it is? I love it.
How bad is that, y'all? Right? You're welcome. Well, let's listen to Katy Perry. Here you were. You were gonna come to me. And here you are. But you better choose carefully. Cause I'm capable of... Uh-oh. Y'all hear the same ostinato? She lost $2.8 million verdict. Guess what happened last month? Last month, Ninth Circuit, and Damien's going to talk more about this case. Katy Perry wins, affirmed, okay? Why? These are the similarities between the two songs. To do a literary analogy, you know, we don't want to find Shakespeare to be an infringer on the basis of his use of articles, pronouns, prepositions, and adjectives used by others. So there has to be more there. That's from a 1940s case. So this is what we're talking about, you know. 8-note ostinato as reflected in numbers. The Ninth Circuit hopefully gave us this demonstration about where you'd find those threes and twos on the piano. They said there's just not enough there. Like, let's be clear, by the way, if I rip off your song, you know, if I rip off Marcus's song, he should come sue me and I should lose, right? Like, if I take a substantial amount of protected material, 100%, that's what copyright's supposed to do. The question is, what if you're talking about this 3-3-3-3-2-2 business? Ninth Circuit says not enough there. Yeah, maybe an eight-note melody, it says, but an abstract 8-note pitch sequence, what you just heard, sadly, not enough. Uh-oh. Okay, again, I'm going to invite you to turn on your ears and tell me, for me to put in her notes, Dua Lipa's Toast after I play this in class, but let's listen to, first we're going to hear the Dua Lipa song that you probably know, Levitating, and then we're going to hear the song of the band that has sued her for infringement.
Do these songs sound the same to you? Dua Lipa, the English pop singer, is getting sued because of the similarities between her 2020 song Levitating and Live Your Life, a 2017 song by the South Florida reggae band Article Sound System.
Uh-oh. Uh-oh. So your ears, there's your eyes. Guess what? Those similarities right there. The rhythm is something we've had since the Charleston. Dun, 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 right? For almost a century now. An F, which is the fifth scale degree, and an E here, kind of unremarkable. Remember the factual copying and legal copying thing? In this particular case, the likelihood that Dua Lipa or any of her fellow songwriters ever heard the first song is pretty remote. The first song was just not out there, not popular. And so the factual copying inquiry is weak. What about the substantial similarity? Well, guess what? Let's listen to some Outkast. Oh yeah, we need some Outkast. Yeah, I'm thinking some people ripped off Outkast, right? Right, this is Rosa Parks, a song involved in a case that my firm worked on involving publicity rights and trademark, but from 1998. And Dua Lipa and her songwriters acknowledged being inspired by Outkast. If they copied from anyone, it was Outkast, not the Miami reggae band. So, but that case is going on right now. What's going to happen? I don't know. There's no musicological analysis in the complaint, which is weird. It's just like, you ripped us off. And it's like, okay. So so game on, now playing these questions proceed, which is why Damien's work is so important. So it's a balancing act, right? Copyright gives artists important control. They need that. But they also need the freedom to use the building blocks of music to create in the first place. If you ask artists, they have conflicting feelings about it. But the apparatus we have now in copyright law is not entirely satisfying, which is why Oh, this is our hopeful image that the staff of music is long, but it will bend towards harmony. You can download our book for free. This is, I'm going to queue up Damien for all the music because he's going to solve all these problems for us. And he's offering a, you know, rather than like tweaking the contours of the law, he's going to give us a technological solution, which is awesome.
At least here's hoping. First, thank you so much for inviting me.
Of course, really thank you for coming. He flew all the way here, like an early morning flight from Minneapolis.
Right, but it's much warmer here than it is Minneapolis.
Yeah, he was like, it's 20 degrees, so thank you.
Yeah, so I'm thrilled to be able to talk about it. And there's the idea of learned hand that is really going to go throughout my presentation because learned hand really cared a lot about independent creation. And so we just heard Dua Lipa. And so the question is substantially similar. Let's raise a hand to see if they are substantially similar. Raise your hand. All right. Raise your hand if you don't think that it's substantially similar. All right. Sadly, it's a trap. That's the wrong question to be asking, which is my fault that I asked the question that was the wrong one. But really, the question is, was it independently created? Is the real question. And that's what Learned Hand said. You know, if you happen to write Ode to a Grecian Urn, if you've never heard the original Ode to a Grecian Urn, you can both have independent copyright in the thing. You can both have, that's the idea that's been around since 1924. So really, the first question is the thing copyrightable in the first place? If it is copyrightable, you may have gone to step two to say, is there access? Was there access to the earlier song? And then, only then do you go to step three, at least in my estimation, are they substantially similar? So that's why it was wrong. It was a trap. I was asking you question three, where you really should be asking question one. Is it copyrightable in the first place? And that's really where my project goes, because if it's not copyrightable, you don't even have to worry about access. You don't even have to worry about substantial similarity. So in 1970, George Harrison had My Sweet Lord, which sounded a lot like the Chopin's He's So Fine. And so you could think that there are only a certain number of melodies that have existed since the beginning of time. And the Chopin's maybe just pulled that out of that existing finite data set, and maybe George Harrison may have also pulled that same existing finite musical data set from there. Under the learned hand, they would say, that's absolutely fine, right? Because you can be able to independently create the same thing, and you're A-OK. Sadly, the court disagreed. They said, you know, I believe you, George Harrison, that you didn't consciously infringe. What I think happened is you subconsciously infringed. Therefore, you're on the hook for however many millions of dollars. And this goes to intent, because almost every other area of the law, if I punch you in the face and intend to punch you in the face, that's different than if I accidentally bump up against you in the face. Right? Intent matters in the law. But here they're saying intent doesn't matter. You could intend to be able to write your own song, but you subconsciously infringe, therefore you're going to have to pay lots of money. But this really goes to access. They didn't really talk about the copyrightability of the thing. So really, the idea of subconscious infringement goes to, is independent creation dead? If I have to prove a negative, if I have to prove that I've never heard a song before, anybody who studied philosophy will know there you cannot prove a negative. You cannot prove that you didn't have access on Spotify, because you have access to every song, essentially, on Spotify. And if you don't have it in Spotify, you certainly have it on YouTube Music, right? So you have access to hundreds of millions of files. And who's to say that you've never heard the song playing over a supermarket loudspeaker? Or who's that you've never heard it playing on a friend's stereo? Or never heard a friend saying, hey, listen to this song on your phone? It's impossible to prove that you've never heard a song. So how can you prove independent creation if the other song is popular enough? How do you prove that it wasn't subconsciously infringed? And the answer is you can't. It's impossible. So maybe it's dead, right? Maybe it's subconscious infringement kills Learned Hand, which makes Learned Hand very, well, he's been dead for a long time, but it's certainly independent creation. Maybe it was dead in the case with George Harrison. So really the idea is, you know, we non-songwriters certainly think that this is the blank slate that all the songwriters have to deal with, but anyone who's written songs knows that it's not a blank slate. You have to avoid these melodic landmines, these songs that have already been done, because if they're not already, even if you haven't heard it, if you happen to land on the same spot, you're in trouble. If you pick a spot that hasn't been taken yet, thank God, right? But if you pick a spot that has been taken, that's a landmine. If you're lucky, you have somebody saying, hey, this song sounds like another song, so they say, you better not do it, and you say, thank God, and they don't let it go out the door. In fact, there are some listening parties. Some of my friends are professional musicians that before the CD gets released or the album gets released, they'll have a listening party saying, if this song sounds like any other song that you know of, let me know, because they'll pull it from then, which is sad. We need more music, right? We shouldn't be pulling music for the fear of getting sued. Because, as Learned Hand said, you can independently create a thing. You shouldn't be worried about this. You shouldn't be worried about stepping on these melodic landmines. So this was the world before my project, All the Music, and this is the world after. What we've done is essentially filled in the entire musical data set. That is every popular song that's ever been, and every popular song that ever can be, and mathematically exhausting. So the way that we do this, I was actually working in cybersecurity at the time. I was a lawyer for 15 years, and then I worked cybersecurity for a company called Strauss Friedberg. Facebook hired me and my company to investigate Cambridge Analytica. So I finished a 12-hour day on Facebook's campus figuring out how bad guys use Facebook data. And I was at the back of the hotel, and I said to my friend Noah, I said, you know how we can brute force passwords? How we can go AA, AB, AC until it hits the person's password? I said, what if we could do that with music, with melodies? What if we could go da-da-da-da, da-da-da-re, da-da-da-me, da-da-fa, until we mathematically exhaust every melody that's ever been and every melody that ever can be mathematically? The way that's reflected in MIDI, which is the way that you reflect music, is looks like this. Do-do-do-do-re, do-do-do-me, do-do-fa. And so Noah responded in a way that I can't say, but he said, hell yeah, but didn't say hell. And so he, at the end of the night, actually, this was a 12-hour workday, he went back and in about an hour and a half, he did a prototype where he mathematically exhausted 3,500 melodies. Now we've gotten the prototype to the point where we have 300,000 melodies per second written to disk in a hard drive in that backpack, and arguably having every melody that's ever been and every melody that ever can be. There's 68 billion with our version 1. We're now at 400 billion melodies that we've written to disk. Anyone who's taken copyright knows that as soon as it's fixed in a tangible medium, a hard drive, it's copyrighted automatically under the Berne Convention. So ostensibly, all 400 billion of these melodies are copyrighted. We also put them all under Creative Commons Zero, which is akin to the public domain. That is, we've said, if you want to use any of these 400 million melodies, you're welcome to do so. This is the data set that we've created. This is 68 billion. The math on this for anyone playing at home is do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. That's 8 up, and then you have 12 across. The math on that is 8 to the 12th power. 8th to the 12th power is 68 billion. That's our major data set. We also did a minor data set. That is do, re, mi, right, minor mode. After that, we did the black notes and the white notes. So we did a 12-tone scale that covers jazz, classical, and then we did the tonic at the top. So that's 13 to the 10th power. So that's 10 melodies. And then we figured, what if we need to do two octaves, just in case? And we just said, okay, the tonic, and then we did the fifth below the tonic, and then we go up an octave, and then we go up a third above that. So now we have major and minor, right? So if you think about C major, that's a major scale, and then you have the A minor is the relative minor of C major, right? So we have now an octave and a half of things in length 10. This is just math, folks, right? If we wanted to make, we want to do more compute time, we could go 16 to the 12, right? We could just, it's just a matter of changing our parameters. This is not any rocket science. So we've made 400 billion today, and maybe we'll make a few others. So we did this in July of 2019. The question is, if you superimpose every song that's ever been, that is every song that's copyrighted, with our exhaustive melodic data set, you have an interesting question. Have we infringed every song that's ever been, and every song going forward that is in the green spot, have they infringed us? Heady, right? We put it all in the public domain, so you don't have to worry about us suing. We're not going to sue anybody. But really, this goes to the question number one, copyrightable. Is it copyrightable or is it not copyrightable? I'm a lawyer, music major. I have a bachelor's degree in music, and I'm also, I've been coding since 85. So, really, the music and the technology side is that melodies, turns out, is really just math, as I just demonstrated. To MIDI, to a computer, the melody, do, re, mi, re, do, is literally, and quite literally, 1-2-3-2-1 is the name of that melody. And so maybe that math is just a fact. Because if I have said, I'm going to copyright 1-2-3-2-1, anyone in the copyright course would say, no, you can't. You can't copyright 1-2-3-2-1. What are you talking about? So maybe that math is just a fact. And maybe that constellation of facts that was described earlier either has thin copyright, almost no copyright, or maybe it doesn't have copyright at all, especially if it's so short that it's just a building block of music. So maybe the melodies, and certainly motifs, aspects of melodies, maybe those either go away if they are dismissed as a matter of law. But sadly, almost everyone focuses on access and substantial similarity. They don't talk about the copyrightability of the thing, or at least they didn't before my talk. And the question on access is Songwriter 2, the later songwriter, did they have access to Songwriter 1? So John Fogerty, did he have access to John Fogerty with Creedence Clearwater Revival? And the answer is yes, he definitely did. If a baby sings into a thing and puts it into a fixed tangible medium, da-da-da-da-da, right? And then Taylor Swift later goes, I stayed up too late, right? clearly no infringement because Taylor Swift didn't have access to the baby. But these two, they never happen, right? Almost always it's in the middle. Sometimes they do have access. Sometimes they don't have access. Sometimes there's a question as to whether they subliminally infringe. So that's where independent creation is pretty much dead because of what you see on your screen here. Everything is a fact question. And so the fact questions, I litigated for 15 years, and you know that the lawsuits, the way that it works, is that you have a cease and desist letter. You pay me money or I'll sue you, right? And if you don't pay me money, you're going to have a long row ahead of you because the fact question doesn't happen at the beginning, but a fact question actually is at the end because this is decided by the fact finder, which is usually the judge or the jury. The jury and the judge is the fact finder. So if you are looking at $2 million of legal fees, $2 million for a song that that doesn't made $2 million, and then have to roll the dice to be able to say maybe I have damage of $1 million on top of the legal fees I've already spent. Why would you go to trial if you don't have the money that Katy Perry does? So Sam Smith was accused by Tom Petty to say, "What is that? Well, I won't back down." Sounds like "Stay with Me," right? Same song. But if Sam Smith says, "Well, I might spend $2 million to roll the dice." Of course, Sam Smith made Tom Petty a co-songwriter. And Radiohead had a song that sounded like the Hollies. And then Lana Del Rey had a song that sounded like Radiohead. Katy Perry actually fought it, as we heard. And so the proof of infringement, the proof of access, was that every one of her co-songwriters said, "I've never heard that Flame song before, that earworm that was awful that you heard earlier." She's never heard that before. None of the co-writers and the plaintiffs didn't show any evidence that they heard it. But the only evidence they said is that we had 3 million YouTube views, so they must have heard it. Oh, and by the way, Katy Perry did Christian music, and Flame is a Christian rapper, so she must have heard it. Right, so this is circumstantial evidence. This is different than the George Harrison case, where George Harrison said, "I might have heard it, I might not have heard it." Right? Katy Perry didn't say that. She said, "I've never heard the song before." Right? Still dinged for $2.7 million. So the proposition that I had for my TED talk, my TEDx talk, was that maybe you should ask question number one, is it copyrightable in the first place? Is that dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun, which, by the way, shows up in my 68 billion database 8,192 times. So my computer crapped those things out at 300,000 melodies per second, and then that shows up at 8,192 times. Is that worth protecting for Flame, for the life of Flame, plus 70 years? For something that I crapped out at 300,000 melodies per second. Is it copyrightable in the first place? And then second, don't worry about hypothetical access, but maybe show that there's actual access. And absent any evidence that there's actual access, that you actually heard it, not circumstantial, but actual access, maybe the case goes away. That's what I argue. So really I focused on, let's take it away from the access question and move more to the copyrightability question. So anyway, I gave my talk in August 4th of 2019. The Katy Perry verdict of $2.7 million happened just 3 days before, 4 days before. It was Tuesday, the verdict came down, and my talk was on Saturday. So I quickly changed my PowerPoint to be able to include the Katy Perry, saying this is how ridiculous this work is. So before the talk, almost all the cases were talking about access and similarity. Almost none of them were talking about copyrightability. So you have the Blurred Lines case. Groove, Vibe, are those copyrightable? In 2018, the Katy Perry case, the judge denied as a matter of law summary judgment, saying as a matter of law, it needs to go forward to the trial. Fast forward to the jury verdict, which happened on Tuesday. And so almost every defendant has lost up to this point, because how do you prove a negative? How do you prove that you've never heard a song before? And because they focus on access and similarity without focusing on the copyrightability. I focused on the copyrightability on Saturday. It took a few months for the TED folks to be able to put it up on the website, but that was actually released on, I want to say, January 29th of 2020, and got a lot of press. This is January 30th, so within a day it had 200,000 views. And then I got interviewed by Adam Neely. Adam Neely's voice was the one that you heard with the Dua Lipa comparison. So I happened to be in Manhattan, and he reached out to me and said, "Hey, could we do an interview?" So I did an interview within a couple of days that had 781,000 views. So it became pretty popular. We made the top post on Reddit on Sunday morning. The Atlantic interviewed me and Noah, and so we had a pretty good distribution on top post on Reddit. I was at church on Sunday morning, and Noah said, "Can you believe it? Can you effing believe it? We're on the top of Reddit." So anyway, so lots of people were talking about it. The Vice had an article on us, The Independent out of the UK, The Telegraph out of the UK. I was invited to the Pho Music Group, which is how I got to know Professor Jenkins, and we had lots of debates as to whether my project was actually going to be discussed or not. And I created a very long FAQ, the Frequently Asked Questions. I'd originally thought of this project as a law review article. I thought, oh, this would be interesting. Maybe I'll do this project, put it on a law review article. I might have a few hundred reads, and that I might actually change the law. But thankfully, this Frequently Asked Questions, Pepperdine asked me to convert this into a law review article. I said, why? Right? I'm getting more press from my talks. I don't know if you know, maybe academics would care, but I don't. So anyway, so after the talk, no apologies to you, Joe. But anyway, so after the talk, it's the shift in the legal precedent seemed to move from access and substantial similarity to copyrightability, where you have, after the talk, within a few months, you have the Ninth Circuit deciding Skidmore, that's the Stairway to Heaven case. And they say the melody was not protectable, going to copyrightability. Right after that, the jury verdict was reversed by the district court judge as a matter of law. The district court threw out the jury verdict as a matter of law. And by the way, remember, earlier she had said that it couldn't be decided as a matter of law. So she kind of flip-flopped post hoc. And then you have the Ninth Circuit doing a bunch of quotes that I could have written for them, right? As a pitch sequence, that's really all is pitch sequences. They're not entitled to copyright protection because these building blocks, what I've been arguing, there are only so many notes, are in the public domain. And that's arguably what I've been doing. And here we are today. And Ed Sheeran just came down this morning. The BBC, as I was getting ready this morning, reached out to me, asked me if I wanted to comment on the thing, but sadly I had meetings, I wasn't able to. But it continues. But really the goal of this is that I wanted the ideas to get out there. Whether my All the Music project actually makes a difference or not, it's really the idea of my All the Music project that really is making the difference, which I hope, you know, correlation is not causation. The fact that all these things turned after mine, they might have never heard my thing. So what I hope is that maybe some clerk or some judge came across my thing and said, yeah, there's only so many notes, right? And especially if you're not a music major, and if you don't even have a musical background, if you look to similarity, of course they're similar. And so every lay jury is going to say, yes, they stole it, obviously. But they need that background to say, oh, there are only so many notes. And so hopefully the idea of my talk was the thing that went through. There are only so many ways to be within constraints and styles. There are only so many ways, especially within eight notes in the Katy Perry case. And they're, it's all common building blocks. You know, how long is that building block? Is 8 the limit? Is 12 the limit? Is 24 the limit? We can discuss parameters as to what are the building blocks or not, but certainly if it's trite, as the ostinato was, it's not protectable, especially the abstract 8-note sequence. So hopefully this focus on copyrightability, which, by the way, is what Ed Sheeran did for his case. He said, here are all the other cases that use the melodic contour that I did. Here are all the other cases before the plaintiffs actually sound like mine. He's focusing on copyrightability. So really the question for Learned Hand, as he's rolling over in his grave over the last bunch of years, is it still dead? Can we still have independent creation? And if we're focusing on copyrightability, it doesn't matter, because you don't even get to that question. You don't even get to access if it's not copyrightable in the first place. So that's thing number one. We have maybe a little bit of time. Does it make sense to go on to machine copyrightability?
Yeah.
1965, the U.S. Copyright Office issued a report because they started having machine copyrightability questions. If a machine creates a thing, do we copyright it or not? Here are some quotable quotes saying that problems of authorship in registering music competition by or compositions by computer, there are a number of works, and the number of works written by computers, the All the Music Project, right? The number of works written by computers is going to increase. And you cannot say that just because it was written by a computer that it will be not denied nearly because a computer has been used. Because after all, a typewriter is also a machine. And so you have to think about is question is whether the work is one of human authorship and merely being an instrument. So the question is, All the Music Project, is that merely a typewriter? Because what we've done is said, okay, go ahead, we've put the parameters, 8 notes up, 12 notes across, and then we created 68 billion melodies. And we said, okay, now we'll do the major minors. So we do 13 notes up, 10 notes across. Are we using it like a typewriter? And if we're using it like a typewriter, should we get copyrightability? Should that be copyrightable? And if somebody else does that. We think of ourselves as white hats because we put these all in the public domain, or at least ostensibly under Creative Commons Zero, it's in the public domain. But what if a black hat does that, right? What if they try to go beyond our side and be able to do more things? Should they be copyrightable? And so the big question is a machine-created work copyrightable, yes or no? If the answer is yes, a machine-created work is copyrightable, then we've copyrighted things, and it's all on Creative Commons Zero. You're able to do it. If the answer is no, the big question is, why is it not copyrightable? One answer might be because they're facts or ideas. As Professor Jenkins said, the idea of an idea within copyright law for music is really tricky. What is an idea? What is a motif? What is a fact? These are all tricky things. But if it's a fact and idea, therefore it's not copyrightable, or maybe it's not original, not creative enough to be able to constitute copyrightability, either one of those, all 400 billion of my things are not copyrightable in the first place. Therefore, public domain. Therefore, anybody can use it. So then, okay, if we reach this logical conclusion, what if a human makes the exact same melody as in our data set? Is the fact that I'm a human creating this unoriginal, uncreative, factual thing, does that all of a sudden make it creative? Somehow like the Schrodinger's cat, that because a human does it, it's good. If a machine did it, it's not good. And what about hybrid musicality? There are lots of tools out there to say, give me an idea for a chord structure. Give me an idea for a melody. And a machine will spit out an idea for a melody, and I say, oh, that's a good melody, I'm going to do it. Is that copyrightable? Is the fact that a machine spit it out, but I say, yep, that's the one, is that copyrightability or not? And so really the objections that most people have to, I think that was actually me making that noise. Apologies to whoever felt slighted. But anyway, a lot of the actuallys that a lot of professors are saying, I don't think that works the way that people, that Damien thinks it's working, is to this first one. If Creative Commons, then it's copyrightable. That goes to the Creative Commons Zero. But really the more interesting question, and really the question I wanted to be able to put out to the world, which sadly, everybody loves the hard drive, right, and they want me to hold it up. Hard drive doesn't matter. It's the idea of uncopyrightability of the thing, 400 billion melodies. That uncopyrightability is the thing that I think it wins the day. And it certainly has been winning the day in the Ninth Circuit in the Katy Perry case. And it won the day in Ed Sheeran in the UK. It's not original. It's not copyrightable in the first place. And we shouldn't give an author, life of the author, plus 70 years for something that my machine craps out at 300,000 melodies per second. This is you may be familiar with this. Somebody tried to file this with the Copyright Office saying, I didn't do anything. The machine created this work. I want to file it with the Copyright Office and get registered. The Copyright Office said, no, you can't. If you hadn't told us, maybe, right? Because we wouldn't know. But now that you've told us that a machine-created thing, we're going to say, no, you can't do it. But what if it's a hybrid work and you don't tell the Copyright Office? So this came up in the music industry list that Professor Jenkins is a part of. And somebody said, well, lyrics, right? And I thought, oh, these lyrics don't exist. Do Not Exist is a website. I went to These Lyrics Don't Exist, and I say, I want a love song that's a country song that's a happy song. And I created a song called Freight Train of Love, which it spit out these lyrics in full form. It had verse one, verse two, chorus, bridge, and then the others. So it fully formed. And I recorded the song where the machine spit out the lyrics fully formed. So the melodies are from all the music, obviously, right? Every melody is machine created. The lyrics are machine created. The drums I pulled from Superior Drummer, which is a way that you can actually take in MIDI, so it has something like 50,000 different loops that I can be able to pull in. So that's all machine created. I arranged, orchestrated, sang, did some other things. I mixed and mastered, and I did the cover art. So when you think about extracting the elements of a song, what parts are human created and what parts are machine created? And most importantly, if I filed this with the U.S. Copyright Office, would they reject it? Because if I don't tell them that the lyrics were spit out by These Lyrics Don't Exist, they would have no idea. How many songs are filed with the U.S. Copyright Office today that are helped and aided by machines? Whether it's a melody helper or a chord helper or a lyric helper. And how do we extract what is human created and machine created? Or really, does it matter, right? These are the questions that I think the Copyright Office should be thinking about. If you submit it to them, they'll have no idea unless you tell them. And then if somebody does lyrics that sound a lot like Freight Train of Love and I sue them, can I win? What if I never tell anybody that I pulled it from These Lyrics Don't Exist? it's a machine-created work that I shouldn't have copyright in, right? At least under ostensibly from the Copyright Office. So if I don't have copyright in the thing, can I sue somebody over the thing? Anyway, old music eating new music in the 2 minutes we have left. Lots of songwriters are selling catalogs. So you have Bob Dylan, you have Bruce Springsteen, you have Sting, hundreds of millions of dollars. I was at South by Southwest a few weeks ago, and the three of the lawyers that were doing a lot of these deals were speaking, and they were saying that this is huge because a lot of people are using them. So I asked, I said, you know, in the 80s, 90s, and earlier, the music industry spent a lot of money on new artists. And the old music was just like, why? Who cares about old music? Because that's just something I sell at a tape in the grocery store for almost no money. So old music got no money. New music got all the money. But from 2000 forward, we stopped investing in new music. If you want to be popular, you are on your own. Right? The record industry is not going to pay for it. They're instead investing all their money in old music. And so I raised my hand at South by Southwest, and I said, is old music eating new music? Because if you look at Spotify streaming, almost all of it is legacy artists. That is the Bob Dylans, the Stings, the others. So old music is pretty much eating new music. And the long tail of new musicians, we're not going to have a Bob Dylan anymore. We're not going to have a Sting anymore. We're not going to have any people because there's a long tail of kind of famous artists, but not really famous artists. So the You Stole My Melody lawsuits that we've been talking about today, is that another example of old music eating new music? That is Tom Petty suing Sam Smith. That's old music eating new music. The Hollies eating Radiohead, eating Lana Del Rey. Marvin Gaye eating Blurred Lines. Is this another way that old music, legacy music, is essentially trying to take more of the pie from new music and making less opportunities for new musicians? So in the end, I hope this trend of going from access and substantial similarity and going up to asking in the first place, is it copyrightable? I hope it continues, and we'll see if there's any idea for maybe independent creation stays. Maybe it goes away, but maybe it doesn't. We have a few minutes.
You responded to all my questions. I was the actually. and so I'm convinced. Oh, yeah, time, but I mean, we started late because...